New Vision Christian Center.
This week, we thank you for keeping us from danger seen and unseen. Lord, as we come in as on one accord, Father, let us worship and let us praise your name. And Lord, as the speaker speak, Lord, let her speak under the unction of the Holy Spirit. As the dancers dance, let them dance under the unction of the Holy Spirit. And as the little angels sing, Lord, let them sing under the unction of the Holy Spirit. Have your way on today, Lord. Lord, we love you, God. We honor you and we praise you, Lord God. Thank you for everything you have done. Thank you for everything that you're going to do, Lord. Bless our pastor, Lord, on this morning, Lord God. Continue to strengthen his bodies. Bless the ministerial staff, Lord God. Bless everybody in their respectable places, Lord. God, we just thank you. We honor you on this morning. And Lord, have your way like never before. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Behold, bless ye the Lord.
Bless ye the Lord.
All ye servants of the Lord.
All ye servants of the Lord.
Which by night?
Which by night?
Stand in the house of the Lord.
Stand in the house of the Lord.
Lift up your hands in the sanctuary.
Lift up your hands in the sanctuary.
And bless the Lord.
And bless the Lord.
The Lord that made heaven and earth.
The Lord that made heaven and earth.
Bless thee out of Zion.
Bless thee out of Zion.
Now we're going to call for the praise and worship singers.
Thank you. together.
Power, power, Lord. Power, power, Lord. Power, power, Lord. Power, power, Lord.
same time, but God told me that we need to keep fighting. I want to read the scriptures that God gave me for empowerment on this morning. It says, Philippians 3, 13 and 14 says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind me and reaching forth unto those things which are before me. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." You know, sometimes when we're going through, we always want to feel like we're being condemned. You know, we have a lot of things that we have faced. We've had a lot of things that we have done. But I just want to encourage you on today, keep fighting. Keep fighting for your faith. Keep fighting for your family. Keep fighting for your peace. Keep fighting for your love. Keep fighting for everything that God has promised you, all his promises, all his blessings. The fight is not easy, but we are more than conquerors through him that loves us. You know, sometimes when we fight and we like, you know, I'm tired. But I want to read Psalms 144 and 1. He said, "Blessed be the Lord, my strength, which teaches my hands to war and my fingers to fight." God wants us to fight. He doesn't want us to give up. He wants us to continue because there's a blessing in the end. There's a blessing in the pressing. There's a blessing in the fight. And you know, I was reading something and it said, you are not fighting to lose. You're fighting to win. You are fighting for what Jesus already won on the cross. This includes your healing. This includes your salvation. This includes your children. This includes your grandchildren. You know, I was blessed this week. My son called me. He said, "Mom, you're a grandma." I found out I got a 3-week-old grandson. And I really wanted to really go off. But God, I said, thank you that he's healthy, that he's here. You know, it was a surprise the way he told me. But I thank God that he's here, that he's healthy. And, you know, it's another person that I have to fight for because he's a part of me. You know, I don't care how grown your children get, you still got to fight for them. You still got to pray for them. You still got to press in for them because sometimes they can't even get a prayer through for themselves. You know, God calls us to intercede, not for our family all the time, but also for one another. If God wakes you up at 3 o'clock and he puts me on your mind, pray for me. If God puts me on your mind at 2, pray for me. If you see me going through, don't talk about me. Pray for me. Because you know what? We got to link arm in arm together. We got to fight in this fight together. I can't fight by myself. We all are part of the army of the Lord. We all need to fight together. If you're interceding and you're riding down the road, pray. If you see an accident, pray. That's part of the fight because we have a spiritual world that we cannot see with natural eyes. And sometimes God calls you to lay on your face. I don't care how sleepy you are, get up out of your bed, lay on your face before God and intercede. We have to continue to fight. This fight has already been won. In Revelations, you win in the end. We win in the end. But in the midst of us winning, we got to remember that we have to fight. And I just pray that I said something that would bless you on this morning. And I pray that you are encouraged. And the next person you will hear from will be my daughter, Sister Stephanie Mahoney, as she comes in and in dance, minister in dance.
You meant for me to soar. I am your child. fighting for. Eyes haven't seen, ears haven't heard. All you have planned for me, and nothing can separate me from your love. When there's so much more still worth fighting for. Now I'm moving by faith and not by sight towards victory. By the power of your might, the strength in my path, and opening every door, I am your child, and I'm worth fighting for. Eyes haven't seen,
ears haven't heard, all you have planned for me,
and nothing, oh nothing,
can separate
me
from your love.
When there's so much more, yeah,
still worth fighting.
Eyes haven't seen,
ears haven't heard.
Family is worth fighting.
so much from a baby. And when you all see her dance, she dances in her testimony, how God has brought her out. And you know, a lot of times when you've been left and abandoned, you are supposed to be counted out, but I thank God for her being counted in on today. I want to go ahead and turn this into over to Deaconess Meeks for our new vision angels. Please give them a hand as they come forward.
Happy and you know. We ready? Watch me. Wait for me. Don't make our turn. My hands are up.
Thank God. Hey, hey.
to minister and dance. I really love him. He's very dear to my heart. Both of them. I got my daughter and I got my godson. So God uses them mightily to dance. So I want to call up our very own Malachi Harris. Give him some as he gives honor to God. And after he dances, the next voice you will hear is our very own pastor, Superintendent William R. Easton.
Thank you. had some help here.
Come on,
I wish I had just two or three people that would just declare it. Somebody sang. I'm just waiting for them. Who is what? Where they at? Here she is. Come on. Somebody give her a clean mic. Never could have made it. And you qualify. You qualify to sing.
I'm better.
I saw Beyonce. I did. And she had two little girls with her. Are those her sisters or her cousins? That's her sisters. And I saw them walking that way. And I remembered when I saw Beyonce and Sanaa, smaller than they are. And now Beyonce is seeing after them. Never would have made it without grandma. She wouldn't have made it without the Lord.
Yes, sir, Pastor.
Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He's the answer. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He's the answer. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He's the answer. He's the answer. He's the answer today. I love him, I love him, I love him. He's the answer. I love him, I love him, I love him. He's the answer. I love him, I love him, I love him. He's the answer. He's the answer. He's the answer today. Yes, Lord. I'm so excited today. I feel good in my soul, and I'm happy to be with you all today. I could have been dead, sleeping in my grave already. But the Lord sustained me.
That's right.
I'm certainly proud and happy about the pulpit. I got a call, an urgent call the other day. I don't know whether it was Saturday or Friday. I don't know what day it was. The missionary minister Campbell called me. She'd been in a car wreck. And some person that was acting crazy. And she called me. I didn't know at the time. Got down, it was a three-car accident. And she was sitting in her car, she nervous and unprotected. Amen. She called, the woman at the police station said, if she called you, she could have called 911. I said, she couldn't get 911. She got me because I answered the phone. don't talk to me like that. Shut up, woman. You thought somebody got some sense. People in a crisis, and you go to the people who's supposed to help you out of the crisis, and they want to treat you like you ain't nothing. That's the problem that we're having with the police now. Amen. Praise God. Certainly this morning has been a wonderful morning. Minister Ephraim and Sister Ephraim are on there. They're going to get acquainted, belated honeymoon, whatever you want to call it. Everybody ought to do that sometime. Take yourself, leave your kids somewhere, and just you and her go somewhere. Amen. Y'all don't like me. But I know I'm telling the truth. The church is not supposed to tap your family. It's supposed to bring you closer together. Amen. But if you like me and like Mother Ephraim was, church just took us over. I lived at the church once I was called to be a deacon. If you could call, I was at the church if I wasn't at work. Amen. Working at the church. I went to the extreme. Amen. My children have reminded me since they've gotten grown what I did to them. And I've had to apologize. Amen. You don't make the mistake. Your family come first. God honors that. Amen. This morning we had a tremendous Sunday school lesson. It's called A Conquering Faith. And I thought it worth me mentioning. Oh, Butler, you did an outstanding job. And it was talking about the love. We are more than conquerors as long as we have the love of Christ in our heart. And I wanted to make sure I remembered the subject. So I got Elder Butler's Sunday school book. And I left mine in the office. And his book is so used, it's all tattered, bent all up. I said, you really use your book. My book looks like it's new. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. It's an honor to me to serve you all. This afternoon, we're scheduled to be over at the satellite with Reverend Mose and New Resurrection at 4. And I'm not going to have time to change clothes. So I'm doing just like I am.
Amen.
Amen. I certainly appreciate those little guys that were singing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Man, I mean, those little guys had their bass for a song. And then Malachi danced. That was tremendous. I didn't get to see our young sister dance. I was in the kitchen working. And I believe something has been being prepared today. I'll let them talk about that. But I'm happy to be here today.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Bless all of you, proud of the pulpit, all of the ministers of the gospel, and the musicians, my granddaughter Chantel. Amen. Malachi, he went to work this last week, but he told him he couldn't work on Sunday because he got to be at church. I'm sorry, Elijah. Amen. That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Good to see Sister Laura back from the homecoming of her brother. Amen. Her second brother in less than a year. Amen. So there's a lot of pain and sorrow going around. But at this time, without any further ado, I want you all to prepare your hearts and mind to receive the speaker today. I'm excited about it. I'm anxious for the word. I'm hoping to see our other members that visit us on the TV, on YouTube, on Facebook. Church is open. Amen. You can come, wear your mask. Amen. We don't want to take no chances. Amen. But I had my shots. Amen. And if they offer a booster, I'm going to take that. Amen. 90% of the people that are in the hospital that are dying are those that have not been vaccinated. And you don't have to get vaccinated if you don't want to. But I'm standing here a living witness. I haven't had a cold since I got vaccinated. don't even have the sniffles. Amen. And usually I got something that happened to me during this time of year. Amen. But God is good, isn't he? I would appreciate it if you would receive our speaker by resting on your feet at this time in the person of Minister Shamika Ford. She's coming in her own way. Say amen for her.
Great Shamika.
You all may be seated. I'm going to try to sing this. I know you get mad when we people just get it. I'm going to try to sing this song. Just try to catch it if you can. Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadows grass, and he leads me beside the quiet stream. He restores my failing health, and he causes me to do what honors him the most. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe. Brother Malachi danced to the perfect song today because the title of this message is I May Be Broken, But I Will Be Better. I want to give honor to God, who's truly the head of my life, to my pastor, to the rest of the ministers on the pulpit, to our deacon and deaconesses, to our district missionary, God bless you, to my husband, Deacon Ford, God bless you. Today's message scripture is going to come from James, the first chapter, verses 2-4. And 1 Peter 4, verses 12 and 13. James 1, 2, and 4. 1 Peter 4, 12-13. James 1 reads, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. 1 Peter 4, 12-13 says, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happening unto you. But rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. Our experiences shape us. For most of us, experiences rather than truth carry more weight in defining our understanding of life than anything else. We all have had experiences that were good and bad, and unfortunately, the bad ones tend to shape us more than the good. If I were to ask you to think of a memory from your childhood or teenage years, most, if not all of you, would automatically think of a negative memory. Why is that? Why do we focus more on the pain of the past instead of the accomplishments or happy times? Psychologists say that it's due to the brain's negativity bias. Our brain is simply built with a greater sensitivity to unpleasant news. Our capacity to weigh negative input so heavily is our instinctual way to keep us out of harm's way. The brain develops systems that would make it unavoidable for us not to notice danger and respond to it. So one can say it's our nature as human beings to try to avoid pain at any cost. We don't like to be uncomfortable, we don't like to be hurt, and we certainly don't like to have pain physically, emotionally, or spiritually. There is one undeniable truth about pain. It is the greatest motivator in taking action to bring about change. As believers in Jesus Christ, pain should motivate us to draw closer to God. It is an unavoidable part of our walk, and we must go through it. If I want to be a mature Christian, then I need to not run away from pain and problems, but use them to develop my faith. The pain you face will either defeat you or develop you. Pain, when responded to correctly, is a character builder. Pain will either move you towards Jesus or away from him. Unfortunately, most people fail to see how God wants to use their pain for the good in their lives. I have had moments when I've said, if this much suffering is what's required to be used by God, then I would rather not be used. We want to be used by God, and we might be willing to suffer some, but we want to determine the timing, the intensity, and the method in which we suffer. The truth is, we want our gifts and talents to make us usable to God, but not our broken hearts and crippling weaknesses. Those that God used are the most messed up, flawed, and thrown away individuals. Those who have endured tremendous pain and brokenness. How many of you know that brokenness is the path to blessing? Before God can use someone greatly, he must break them in order to rebuild them correctly. God must break us for several reasons. One is to break us from our own self-dependence. If we have any resources that we can use ourselves, then we still rely on that and not God. We mess up our own blessings and increase our suffering by trying to play the role of God and not trusting him. There are great examples of what happens when people try to help God or acquire blessings without waiting on God's perfect timing. Sarah allowed another woman into her bed. Rebecca hatched a plot to trick an elderly man, and Jacob schemed his way to acquire the things God had already promised him. And because of the help that they gave God in their situation, they ended up not only messing up their lives, but others had to pay the price. Because they created another problem for God to fix in order to go back and do what he was originally going to do. So self-reliance will prolong your suffering. I'll use an example in marriage. I'll use my marriage. I'm sorry, I'm telling our business again. Hold on. It's a purpose. I will pray, Lord, save him. I can't stand him. He get on my nerves. I need help. I don't want to do this. And I would pray and I would say, Lord, just fix him for me. Just fix it. And the Lord said, you want me to fix it? I said, yes. And he said, okay, well, it's going to hurt a little bit, but just hold on. And so I'll get mad at him and he would do something. And I just try to hold my peace. I just hold my peace. And I just pray. And I would do good for about 2 days. Yeah. And then on that third day, it was, you know what? That's it. I mean, just go completely off. There might have been some cuss words. I'm saying now. But there might have been some cuss words that came out too. And then God said, what? Didn't I tell you to be quiet? Because all I did was prolonged. Now he got to start all the way over because I couldn't hold my peace and be quiet. Now God had to go back. He got to fix that. That's going to take a couple weeks because I said some things that was pretty terrible. So it's going to take a couple weeks to fix that. Then I got to start all the way over. Sometimes it behooves you to just be quiet. Sometimes it's not worth all of that. You say what you got to say in your head. You go outside and take a walk. I remember one time Deacon Ford said, go take a walk. I said, this in a word right here. Told me to take a walk. I put my shoe on him, tell me to take a walk. By the time I made it around the block, I was like, what are we going to eat for dinner? So my advice to y'all women is take a walk. And if your husband tells you to, don't take your earrings off and try to fight. I mean, I'm yeah, I'm trying to tell y'all, I'm trying to save y'all from the pain that I went through. Another reason God has to break us is to reveal to us the power of our flesh. Part of the process of knowing God involves knowing ourselves. Until God reveals the power of our sinful nature to us, we tend to think that we're okay. We tend to think that there's nothing really that wrong with us, and we're not that bad. We look at other people and compare sins and say, well, I've done that, but I've never done what brother or sister so-and-so did. It's easy to judge the actions of others and proclaim your righteousness, but the word says even your righteousness is a filthy rag. So get somewhere and sit down and stop acting like your life don't stink, because if we look somewhere, I guarantee your life is stinking somewhere. You just hide it better than the other person. Just because you think that something that you may do is small, it doesn't mean that it's any less deadly to your spiritual man. The word says it's the small foxes that destroy the vine. Foxes appear to be innocent, but they're actually crafty and clever animals. We think that a beautiful little fox stealing a few grapes isn't that harmful, but it can do surprisingly a lot of damage. Small foxes in our character that we may not even notice, like jealousy, dishonesty, or selfishness, for example, we might complain a little bit, we might act in a mean way or speak carelessly, hurting other people's feelings. Just like the grapes that must be protected from the little foxes, we have to protect our character from our little faults that we might not even notice. These can spoil or even destroy the positive Christ-like qualities that we're trying to develop. You may be one of those people that think they aren't that bad. I used to think that at one point during my walk, but the more that I've grown in the Lord, the more I see, as Paul said in Romans 7 and 18, nothing good dwells in me, that is in my flesh. Until the Lord can reveal that to us, we depend more on ourselves than Him. Many of us have heard people are like tea bags. If you want to know what's inside of them, just drop them in some hot water. Pain will show you what you're made of. It will show you if what you thought was really gone is really gone. When we go through pain, we tend to default to something. What we should default to is running to the Father. But some of us default to anger or aggression. Some of us default to a text message or a phone call to someone we used to be intimate with. For some, it's cutting themselves or thoughts of suicide. And for some, it's the liquor bottle. And for some like me, it's food. Whatever your vice is, pain will show you if you've been fully delivered from it. Pain will show you if you meant what you say, if you're really practicing what you preach. God's breaking process reveals to us the power of our flesh. The third reason God has to break us is to show us how powerful He really is. We view obedience to God as an option that's available to us. We think we're in control, directing things as we think best. We choose our careers, our lifestyle, our schedule, and it's all centered around what will make us happy. Sometimes we look at God as a soft-spoken God that we can call on when our plans aren't working, or just so He can make our plans work. And we forget His awesome power and sovereignty. So He has no choice but to cripple us, wipe us out, to help us understand and remember that He is God. We learn His awesome power and we must follow His plan, because there is no other choice. We learn that disobedience is not an option, but a must. Disobedience is a terrible thing. Disobedience is nothing more than the result of the spirit of rebellion. And the spirit of rebellion is witchcraft.
You gotta say that.
1 Samuel 15:23 says, for rebellion is as sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Just thought I'd throw that in there in case some of y'all are operating in the spirit of rebellion this morning. Pain has a purpose. That's why God uses it. God uses your pain to direct you. Sometimes God must light a fire under you to get you moving. Pain often points us in a new direction and motivates us to change. Is God trying to get your attention? Sometimes it's just a painful situation that will help us make a change. It will help us to change our ways. Some lessons we learn only through pain and failure. It's like a child when the parent tells them not to touch a hot stove. I don't care how many times you tell that child don't touch that hot stove. They're not going to be satisfied until they touch it and burn themselves. And then they learn the lesson and they won't touch the stove no more. So sometimes, if we continue to be disobedient to God, if we continue to just walk in whatever we want to do and not consult God, He will allow us to do it, and we'll think that it's a blessing and He's making a way for us. But in reality, He's allowing you to touch that stove to burn your hand. So it's good for you to consult God in everything. Consult God before you take that job. It may pay you a lot of money. But there might be, what they say, Jody. Jody might be waiting on that job.
Stop. Come on, man.
There might be a trap waiting for you at that job. So you better consult God if this is where I need to be right now.
Yes, 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 yes.
Sometimes we only learn a valuable lesson when something like our health, money, and relationships are lost. Sometimes something has to be completely taken away from you in order for you to understand what the value of that thing is.
All right.
You don't want to get to that point where something has to be stripped from you for you to realize how important it is. Your relationships are important. Your husband, your wife, they're important. So don't take them for granted, because one day they're not going to be here. One day you're going to get up and you're going to be by yourself. And you're going to be looking around thinking about what you had, and you don't have it anymore. When you're in a breaking process, it's hard to gain insight and its value and understanding why God is allowing it to happen. You can't see past the tears, past the hurt, deep down in your heart. The aching feeling that happens when you're on the verge of just giving up and you lost all the hope and you don't believe that things will get better anymore. You cry and you get angry, and you cry and you lash out and you cry and you wonder why God is allowing it. And you ask yourself, God, I thought you loved me. I don't understand. I thought this was my time. I thought this was my season. You promised me. I worked hard in the church. I've given up so much. I lived my whole life for you. I've literally given you everything I know how to give. And you allow this to happen? You let me get fired? You let my loved one die? You let my marriage dissolve? You let my child go to jail? You let them lie on me? You let them use me and abuse me? You let me be homeless? What am I missing? And we're all asking those questions. We're all failing to realize is that God would never do anything to be cruel. He loves us too much to ever hurt us unless there's something greater at the end of it. His love for us is so great that He is far more interested in our salvation and our character than our comfort. I'm going to say that again. God loves us so much that He is far more interested in our salvation and our character than our comfort. He knows that if you endure these things, it will save you from missing something amazing that He has lined up for you. He knows that if you endure this thing, there's a person 7 years from now that will hear your testimony and be strengthened to carry on in their darkest moment. He knows that our greatest victories come out of the ashes of our greatest defeat. His love for us is immeasurable. He loves us so much that He exhausted every means necessary to save us. And He sent His beloved Son, Jesus, to die for us. He loves us so much that He will put up with our doubt and our questions and our disobedience, our bad attitudes, and He will give us grace and mercy. We may not understand Him, but understand him. Yes. All we have to understand is he loves us.
Yes.
And trust him.
Yes.
Trust that he has our best interests at heart.
Yes.
Trust that he knows us better than we'll ever know ourselves.
Yes.
So don't allow yourself to grow bitter when pain comes during the breaking process. Say to yourself, I may be broken, but I will be better. Continue to seek God in your dry place. Endure the waiting with patience and expectation. Submit your life to God and allow your brokenness to make you better. If you allow God to use the pain instead of you resisting his will for your life, he will fix it for you. He will turn your sorrow into joy. He will turn your mourning into dancing. When you trust his plan, those who are held under will rise above. When you trust his plan, those who are in the background will be set to the forefront. When you trust his plan, those who are depressed will once again begin to rejoice. When you trust his plan, those who are rejected will feel the acceptance through Jesus. When you trust his plan, those who have been beaten down will have their strength renewed. When you trust God's plan, those who are poor will say, I am rich. When you trust God's plan, those who are struggling with sickness shall be healed. When you trust God's plan, those who are afflicted will once again walk in wholeness. When you trust God's plan, you can say it may be broken, but it's going to get better. Trust in the Lord. Know that you don't have the answers. Know that you'll never understand what he's trying to do. But there is one thing that you need to understand, and that's that the God we serve loves us. And because he loves us, he's never going to do anything to just break us down. Everything he allowed is going to make us better. It's going to make us stronger. It's going to make us wiser. Because the God that we serve is an awesome God. None beside him, none above him. He is God and God Almighty. The only one who can fix your problems. The only one who can heal that bad attitude. The only one who can stir up that marriage. The only one who can heal your body. God is able if you let him be God. Let God be God. Anything. Let God be God. And what's so great about God is he knows you hurting, but he's right there with you the whole time. He is literally letting something happen that's going to break your heart, but at the same time he's holding your heart. He's wiping your tears away, and he's telling you you can make it. I was telling my son yesterday, me and Deacon Ford were telling our son yesterday, we said something and he just flipped it, took it negative, and then it became something else. And I said, nobody said you was weak. I said you were strong. But you need to strengthen here. You need to strengthen here. I told him, you could have the most muscles in the world. You could be the strongest person. You can have all the resources. You can have all the money. But if you weak in here, you're not going to make it. God can put everything in our hands. He can give us everything we need to make it. But if we're not strong here, we ain't going to make it. You got to pray over your mind. Because your mind dictates your actions. I said it a couple months ago at the revival. Your mind goes unchecked. The only person that can check your mind is you. So if your thoughts are negative, if your thoughts are I'm weak, watch yourself. Because if you are in a point in your life where you're realizing that your words have become more negative, your mindset has become more negative, you may not say it outwardly, but on the inside, oh, that's never going to happen. Oh, I'm this and that. God can't use me. Watch that. Because that should let you know that you're under attack. When your thoughts become negative like that, you are under attack.
Come on,
you need to anoint your mind.
Come on, Mika.
Put some oil up here.
Come on, baby.
And pray over your mind.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Because if you are, that's the warning sign. That, let that be the warning sign to you today. That if you are walking around and your thoughts have become negative, the words that you speak have become negative, you are under demonic attack. And you need to pray. And if you can't do it by yourself, you need to call somebody else. That is the beginning of the slippery slope that the enemy is trying to take us on. Hold on to your mind. Fight for your mind. Minister Ephraim, she always said, I could have been crazy. Playing with crayons. And we laugh sometimes, but that's true. Hold on to your mind. And how do you do that? You renew your mind. How you renew your mind? Through the word. Because your mind is going to lie to you every time. Your mind is going to tell you lies. It's going to tell you you're not good enough. It's going to tell you nobody loves you. It's going to tell you you're not worth it. It's going to tell you they was right for leaving you. You should have had more to offer. It's going to lie to you. So combat every lie that the enemy tells you with the word of God. If you, I'm giving y'all some homework tonight.
Yeah, do it.
I want y'all to write down every negative thought that you've been meditating on recently. Every negative thought. Then I want you to go to the word of God. And I want you to find a scripture that calls that out as a lie. Find the truth. And when you feel like that, go back to it, look at it. And when you want to say, I'm a failure, you go and you find a scripture that says that he's able to give you the strength you need to make it. You can do it.
Come on.
My God.
Come on.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're our worst enemy.
Yes, sir. Come on now.
I know I'm my worst enemy.
Come on.
I would dog myself out before I can let somebody else do it. And I think that that's helping me because it's preparing me for what somebody else is going to say. But really, it's not.
No, it's not.
It's not doing anything but hurting me.
Yeah, yeah.
We're so busy hurting ourselves.
Yeah.
And you know, the enemy is slick because what he will do is he will set up something in your mind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He will set up something in your mind and then he'll leave you. Because he don't need to be there no more because you're going to keep hurting your own self.
Yeah.
Over and over. So he just deposits it and drops it, and then he just back away. I don't know if this is what he do, but he do something. And then he just watches you destroy your own self.
Come on, baby. Yes, sir.
He will plant seeds of doubt in your mind to have you questioning, is God real?
Yes, sir.
Did Jesus really die, or was that just some man or something like that? He will plant seeds and then have you destroy your own self.
Yes, he will.
So how do you guard that? How do you stop that from happening? You get in his word. You seek his face.
Yes.
You pray.
Yes.
Guard your mind.
Yes.
Guard your heart.
Yes.
Guard your spirit. Yes. And who you're hanging out with. Yes. Pay attention.
What?
Pay attention to who you're hanging out with.
That's right.
As much as you love them, that may not be who God wants you to be with in this season.
Yes.
And just because you need to separate yourself doesn't mean you feel a certain way about a person. But if God is telling you to separate yourself, listen.
That's right.
It's the small foxes. Before you know it, you will be somewhere trying to figure out how you got there. Because you're hanging out with the wrong people. And they fun, and they funny, and you be laughing, you have a good time. But then they plant little things in your conversation. But before you even realize that it's affecting your spirit, you already messed up. Don't even know.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Guard your spirit.
Oh my God.
Guard your mind.
Oh my God.
Pay attention to who you're hanging out with.
Come on.
Pay attention to who you're talking to.
Come on, baby.
I know that there's people that I can talk to when I want to be negative.
Come on.
And there's people I can't talk to when I want to be negative because they're not going to allow me.
What you say?
So when I want to be negative, I know who to call. I'm not calling that one.
No, you ain't.
When I want to be negative, I know exactly who to talk to. Because you know why? Because they negative too. So all you doing is feeding each other foolishness.
That's all you doing. That's all you doing.
Feeding each other foolishness. So you need to find somebody that's going to hold you accountable.
That's it.
Somebody that's going to tell you the truth when you don't want to hear it. Dana told me something the other day. I was like, psh.
Bless the Lord.
And then I was like, yeah, Lord, she right. And I love her for it, because they don't tell me. Find somebody that'll tell you the truth about yourself. We're not that lovely. We're not that great.
Amen.
From the pulpit to the door. Matter of fact, all of us up here probably more crazy than y'all. And you know why? Because God called us. And like I read before, he calls some people that have been through some things. And each and every one of you have been called. Not up here. That might not be your calling, but you've been called. And if God calls you, he's going to qualify you. And the way he qualifies you is through your testing.
I felt that my answer.
That's how he qualifies you. It's not because you show up on time. It's not because you want a title. It's not because you shout good. It's not because you sing good. He calls you and he qualifies you by you standing the test. Standing firm. That's how you get qualified. Oh God, thank you. That's how he qualifies you. We get up and we, I'm called and I'm qualified because he called me. You ain't qualified yet. The qualification is a process. He didn't put everything in you so you can qualify. But if you don't pass the test, you ain't qualified yet. So endure hardness as a good soldier. Fight through it. Fight through it. When you don't understand it, when you're tired, fight through it. When you don't understand it, fight anyway. When you're tired of crying yourself to sleep, fight. When the people around you don't understand you and you feel like they don't love you, fight. When you want to do wrong, fight. When you want to give up, fight. When you want to tell them off, fight. When you want to be disobedient to God, fight. Fight for your life. Fight for your mind. Fight for your children. Fight. Because people can only drag you so far. They can only pull you so far. You got to reach down on the inside and fight for your own self. It's a selfish walk. People are great and you need people. But at the end of the day, it's coming down to you and you only. It's not what mama did. It's not what daddy didn't do. It's not what sister so-and-so said. It's not about the lies they told on me. It's not about the fact that they mistreated my children. It's about you and God. We can't do what we want to do and justify it because they did something. I always tell my kids and Deacon Ford, I said, when you stand before God, you're going to say, I cussed that lady out because she shouldn't have hit me or hit my car or pushed my car. No. That you cussed the lady out. That was you. That was a choice you made. So you can't do unto others the way that they do unto you. You got to do better. You got to do better than them. If they don't want to talk to you, if you speak and they roll their eyes and keep walking, you spoke, right? So you all right. My mama tell me all the time and my pastor tell me all the time, get your feelings off your sleeve, put them in your pocket. Yes, he do. He can be mean about it.
Yeah, he do. And then laugh at it.
Yep, that's right.
Yes, he do.
Yeah,
he
do. Stop allowing your feelings to dictate how you respond to situations. The Lord has really been dealing with me about feelings because feelings will mislead you. They will take you somewhere. And have you thinking that something is way worse than what it really is. And then you done showed out and showed your rear end. And then it ain't even that big of a deal. And then now you're living crazy.
Wow.
Get out your feelings.
Bless the Lord.
And get in some Jesus.
Yes, hallelujah.
Because that's the only way we're going to make it. Because our feelings are they'll mislead you.
That's it, Jesus.
And your feelings is just that, they feelings. It don't make it truth. Just because you feel like somebody don't like you, that doesn't make that truth. That's just how you feel. That person's probably not even thinking about you. Not even looking at you. Or they going through their own stuff. And you mad because they didn't speak to you. But they probably didn't even see you. So when you're going through and you remember, even though it hurts right now and I feel broken and I feel like I don't know where I'm going, what's going on, what am I gonna do, when you feel like that, remember that you serve a God that loves you. And if he's allowing you, somehow, some way, he's gonna make it good. You may be broken, but it's gonna get better. It's gonna get better. Trouble don't last always. Pain don't last always. Tears don't flow always. Some way, somehow, it's gonna turn around. If you hold on, and if you fight the fight.
Guys just get better and better. Better and better. My God, what a word. I know that was to me. You gotta control your mind. I know that was to me. Amen. Deacon Allen, I was at, maybe somebody in, everybody in here look like all these are members. We don't have not one visitor today. Well, who? Are you Bonaparte? Is that your last name? Bonaparte?
No? My last name was Pittman.
Stand up just a minute. I don't mean to. Y'all got the mask on. I can't tell who y'all are. Tell us who you are.
Akaya Karis. I used to go to your church with Miss Pittman, Corinne Pittman. I was a member a while back.
All right. Thank God. Well, I'm happy you're here today. I don't know about you, but that word reached me today.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That dance reached me too.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. It reached me because it revealed to me how far down I am. I was getting ready to leave Sam's out on D Street yesterday. And I had to say, I'm going to get me some gas because I get 5 cents off a gallon. Drove my truck over there and got my gas and everything going good. I got the chickens and I got everything for the dinner today that Deaconess Icy and them are doing for you, for whatever their purpose is. I'm feeling all good. I got my truck full. Pulled out, got ready to go on the street, and someone come up to the stop sign, up and sped around and shot down through there, and I was already out there, and they blew their horn at me, and I blew my horn back at them. I don't never do that. I'm so calm when I'm driving. I don't never say nothing. But that, I hit my horn on the ass, and I tried to blow them off the highway. When they turned around, I think I might have scared them. They thought I might, in that big black escalator, I might have had a gun or something. They sped on around and got to the light and cut out. And while they were doing that, I said to myself, now look what I done done. Wow. Just that quick, my flesh took over. I felt good when I blew the horn. I feel bad when I thought about what I had done. You gotta be careful.
Yes, sir.
Satan is crouched at the door.
Yes.
Least thing you let him in, he'll take
come
over.
Come on, weakest link. Come on, Pastor.
But I'm glad that God knows me.
Yes, sir. He knows my name. Come on now.
Hallelujah.
The minute I did it, my lawyers, my accuser in heaven, he said, look, see, he ain't that. But my lawyer said, no, he's all right. I got a lawyer that's defending me. He stands before the Father. I'm saved right now. Not because I'm good, but because I'm under His grace and His mercy. He understands me. He knows me. He knows who I am. He took my sin on Himself. He knew I couldn't have it. The Father sent His Son so I could get delivered.
Thank you, God.
And all of the negatives that I deal with, I'm working on me to bring them under control. I'm not there yet, but I am under the blood. So when He sees me, He really don't see me. He sees the blood. And when He sees the blood, He passes over me. That's what Passover is about. That's why on the first Sunday, we're going to do communion.
All right.
Hear
me. Yes, yes.
Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. I'm not going to prolong the time. I believe it's time for offering. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Am I?